mum or dad or whoever brought you here this morning. Love having the kids in over the school holidays, so the regular kids' church isn't happening, which means we try and make our services more kid-friendly. So we've got an activity for the kids a bit later in the service. Come and grab a seat. We'll make a start. Okay, well, welcome along to Make Church. It's great to see everyone. I don't know if it was a struggle for you to get out of bed this morning and get to church, or whether maybe it's a first time to church, or maybe you were super excited to be at church. Praise God. But whatever your story, we're really glad that you've made it here, and we trust that God will bless you as we spend time looking at His Word and meeting with Him. I was listening to just a short clip on Facebook yesterday, and it had this phrase in it about the high praises of God, and the high praises of God in the public square, actually. But it came back to me this morning. I watched it again, and it just got me thinking about how God is, He is high. He is the highest one. He is above all else. And I went searching for a part of Scripture that would talk about that. I found Psalm 9, which I thought would be a good way to start our service as we come to meet with our God who is high and lifted up. So this is the start of Psalm 9. David is the one who wrote it. It says, "I will give thanks to you, Lord, with all my heart. I will tell of all your wonderful deeds. I will be glad and rejoice in you. I will sing the praises of your name, O Most High." And he goes on, just a couple more verses. "My enemies turn back, they stumble and perish before you, for you have upheld my right and my cause, sitting enthroned as the righteous judge." So we come before God who is most high. He is the one who is enthroned as our righteous judge. And so let's come before Him. I'm just going to pray and then we're going to stand and sing together. But let's pray. Father, we come before you this morning as the most high God. You are above all, and we come in praise, we come in worship. We want to lift up your name and declare that you are the most high God. And Father, we pray that as we come before you today, that you would lift yourself up in our hearts. We invite the Holy Spirit to come, Lord, that we might glorify the name of Jesus, that we might call on you as our Heavenly Father, that we would find ourselves as your loved children. And Father, we thank you that we are called that because of you. And so, Lord, just be with us now as we begin with praise. Lift our hearts to lift you as the Most High God. And we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand and we'll sing praise to God. Thanks.
Thousand reasons for my heart to fall. bless the Lord, oh my soul. Strength is failing, the angels kneel, and my time has come. Still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore. So bless the Lord, oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before. Oh, my soul, I will worship Your holy name. I will worship Your holy name. I will worship Your holy name. Feet may fail, and there I find You in the mystery, in oceans deep, my faith will stand, and I will call upon Your name. Keep my eyes above the when oceans rise, my soul will rest in Your embrace. 'Cause I am Yours, and You are mine. Your grace abounds in deepest waters. Sovereign hand will be my guide. When feet may fail and fear surrounds me, You've never failed and You won't stop now. And I will call upon Your above the waves. When oceans rise, my soul will rest in Your embrace. 'Cause I am Yours, and You are mine. Spirit, where my trust is without borders, let me walk upon the waters. Wherever You call me, send me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon. me walk upon
Okay, well, grab a seat, everyone. Well, kids, as I said, we've got a bit of an activity for you a little later in the service. But just to start with now, we're looking at just one verse in Isaiah is what we're particularly focusing on, Isaiah 7:14, which talks about how there would be a child born of a virgin woman who would be God with us, Immanuel. And so we're going to start thinking into that passage now. In Isaiah chapter 7, where this verse comes from, it's verse 14. But in that chapter, God told King Ahaz, he told him not to be afraid. And so just to refresh us, particularly for the adults, but also for the kids, to give a bit of context. So Isaiah, he was prophesying and speaking God's word for maybe like 65 years, the scholars think. And so that was through the reign of four different kings in the nation, the southern part of the kingdom, God's kingdom of Judah. And so this king is the third king that Isaiah was prophesying to, and his name was Ahaz. And so God gave Ahaz a promise. It was an amazing promise that he would be with his people, that he would be God with them. And he promised to be that this baby would be born to kind of fulfill this promise. That baby would be called Immanuel, which means God with us. But King Ahaz, he didn't really listen to the promise. He was still afraid. He failed to trust God. But children, God, whether we trust him or not, he is good to his word. And so he came through on this promise. And we're going to think now about kind of the big way that this promise came true. And then in the sermon, we'll think a bit more about how that relates to us today. But let's think about how this promise came true. So God did come to live with us. The years passed after Ahaz. And one day there was a young girl called Mary. So I think we've got a picture of Mary on the screen. There's Mary. And Mary was visited by an angel, and Mary was pretty afraid of that angel, but the angel said, "Don't be afraid, you don't need to fear. You're going to have a son, and you'll call him Jesus, and he will be God's forever king." And then the angel disappeared. And Mary was married, or pledged to be married actually, promised to be married to a man named Joseph, and Joseph found out that Mary had a baby in her tummy. They weren't married yet, and so Joseph decided that he wasn't going to marry Mary anymore. But then, one night, an angel came and appeared to Joseph. He was asleep. The angel came. He was afraid, but the angel said, "Don't be afraid again. You don't need to fear. God has put this baby in Mary's tummy. He will be called Jesus, and he will save the people from their sin." And then the angel disappeared again. And so Joseph did what the angel told him. He married Mary. And in this picture on the screen, you can see Mary and Joseph, they were travelling to Bethlehem, there was a census, there was lots of people around. You probably know the story that we recount every Christmas time. And so Mary had her baby in a manger, as the story goes, with the cows and the sheep, and they called the baby Jesus. And on that same night that Jesus was born, another angel appeared, this time to some shepherds in a field outside Bethlehem. And they were told about this baby that was going to be born. They were afraid, but the angel said again, "Don't be afraid, you don't need to fear. I have great news. Today a baby is born, you'll find him lying in a manger. He is king of everything and he will save his people from their sins." And suddenly you had lots of angels appearing and they sang songs of high praise to God. And then they disappeared. And the shepherds went, they found Jesus there in the manger, just as the angels had said. And so all of this happened just the way Isaiah had said some 700 years before. There would be a baby that would be born. He would be Immanuel, God with us. And God himself would come as a human and he would die for us and he would save us from our sins. And so we don't need to live in fear. We don't need to be afraid because God has taken the punishment for us. How amazing is that? That is the Christmas story in a nutshell. But we're going to think a bit more about that now. So we've got a couple of Bible readings, both about the angels appearing to Joseph, but then also that passage from Isaiah, and then I'll be speaking from that. So I'll invite Christy. I think Christy is going to come up and read us the Bible readings, and then we'll have the talk from those. Thanks, Christy.
Okay, so the first reading this morning is from the New Testament. So Matthew chapter 1, verse 18 to 24. So Matthew chapter 1, verse 18 to 24. This is how the birth of Jesus the Messiah came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph, but before they came together, she was found to be pregnant through the Holy Spirit. Because Joseph, her husband, was faithful to the law and yet did not want to expose her to public disgrace, he had in mind to divorce her quietly. But after he had considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins." All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet. "The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Immanuel, which means God with us." When Joseph woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him and took Mary home as his wife. The second reading is from Isaiah chapter 7, verse 1 to 17. So Isaiah chapter 7, 1 to 17. When Ahaz, son of Jotham, the son of Uzziah, was king of Judah, King Rezin of Aram and Pekah, son of Remaliah, king of Israel, marched up to fight against Jerusalem, but they could not overpower it. Now the house of David was told, "Aram has allied itself with Ephraim." So the hearts of Ahaz and his people were shaken, as the trees of the forest are shaken by the wind. Then the Lord said to Isaiah, "Go out, you and your son Sheer-Jashub, to meet Ahaz at the end of the aqueduct of the upper pool, on the road to the launderer's field. Say to him, 'Be careful, keep calm, and don't be afraid. Do not lose heart because of these two smouldering stubs of firewood, because of the fierce anger of Rezin and Aram of the son of Remaliah. Aram, Ephraim, and Remaliah's son have plotted your ruin, saying, "Let us invade Judah. Let us tear it apart and divide it among ourselves and make the son of Tabor king over it." Yet this is what the sovereign Lord says. It will not take place. It will not happen. For the head of Aram is Damascus, and the head of Damascus is only Rezin. Within 65 years, Ephraim will be too shattered to be a people. The head of Ephraim is Samaria, and the head of Samaria is only Remaliah's son. If you do not stand firm in your faith, you will not stand at all. Again the Lord spoke to Ahaz, "Ask the Lord your God for a sign, whether in the deepest depths or in the highest heights." But Ahaz said, "I will not ask. I will not put the Lord to the test." Then Isaiah said, "Hear now, you house of David. Is it not enough to try the patience of humans? Will you try the patience of my God also? Therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and will call him Immanuel. He will be eating curds and honey when he knows enough to reject the wrong and choose the right. For before the boy knows enough to reject the wrong and choose the right, the land of the two kings you dread will be laid waste. The Lord will bring on you and on your people and on the house of your father a time unlike any since Ephraim broke away from Judah. He will bring the king of Assyria.
Okay, well, it'll be helpful if you have that passage in front of you on a phone or something, Isaiah chapter 7. We'll be coming back and having a bit of a look at that. Well, during the week on Friday, I went along to Mackay Churches Together. It's kind of a grouping of different churches in town that get together for fellowship and unity activities. We had our end of year celebration lunch. And so one of the things we were doing at the lunch, naturally kind of sharing about what each of us were up to over the holidays and what our churches did on the holidays. And I was mentioning in a conversation with Jay that we have the two Sundays off after Christmas Day. And we were kind of just talking about how for our church family, that's normally a really exciting time when we do come back together in the new year, that we haven't seen each other for a few weeks. And so there's kind of a bit of a buzz to see each other. And then I thought back and I thought to 2022, I wasn't actually here for the first service at the start of this year, but it was a little bit more awkward if I put an image on the screen. That was the kind of masks at the start of the year. So the borders had opened, COVID was spreading. We rocked up and some people were wearing masks and some people weren't wearing masks. And that was a little bit tricky to walk through as a church family. Maybe it's a bit awkward to raise it. But, you know, as I think back over 2020 for myself and just for us as a church family, one of the things that I'm actually really thankful for our church family is how we were able to walk through the whole mask thing and COVID thing and actually find some unity in amongst the diversity. We're actually able to love each other and had the ability to talk to each other, even though we didn't necessarily see eye to eye on everything, but just the ability to actually listen to one another, I see that as a really positive thing. And I think it actually stood us in good stead as we continued working through the Bible this year. We kind of did cover a few tough topics. We went through Proverbs and then Philippians and then into 1 Timothy and our series through 1 Timothy, The Kingdom Coming. And so we talked about prophecy and speaking in tongues and different spiritual gifts and apostles and different roles in the church and the place of men and women. There are a few tough topics to actually face as a church family. But again, I think we did it in unity and love and honesty. Not necessarily agreeing about everything, but just that willingness together to face those topics. It was really an invitation to think and grow and be pushed and a little bit challenged. And I'm just really thankful for the way that you guys have persevered through all of that, stuck through all of those conversations, and here we are, we've made it to the end of 2020. So that's something as I sit back and reflect on this year, it's something that I'm really thankful for in our church family life. And I was just this week, as we come to the topic that we're looking at today, we're partly looking at the topic of faith. And it just kind of struck me how to be thankful. You do actually need faith. You actually have to have some confidence that we're moving somewhere positive so that as you see the little signs of those good things happening, you can recognize them for what they were. You need faith to actually be thankful. And so really the question for us today is how do we strengthen that? How do we build faith that even in this world that is broken and hurting and where there is disagreements, we can have the faith to kind of move through it and to see the good things that are happening even though there might still be challenges. Well, just at that point, I'm going to pause for a second. So kids, I've talked about being thankful on the back of faith. And so what we've got for you now is an activity. So if you want to head to those tables again up the back, we've got an activity for you. You're going to get a sheet there with a Christmas tree on it. And so the first thing that I want you to do, so you've got to listen carefully, kids, as you're getting yourself set up on the tables. The first thing I want you to do, kids, is on those sheets with the Christmas tree, is to try and jot down something that you're thankful for in 2022. So did you hear that? Something that you're thankful for in 2022. So adults, you can maybe be thinking of that as well. Maybe there was a particular teacher that you were really thankful for. Maybe you're thankful that you just survived school for the year. Maybe there was something good that happened for you during the year that you're thankful for. Maybe some other hardship that you made it through. So jot down on that sheet something you're thankful for. And then there's a few other instructions. So you've got to colour in your Christmas tree. It'll say on your sheet whether you're colouring yours red or green. You've got to then do the decorations, colour those in, and then cut them out. And if you look at the screen, kids, so this is where we're heading, all your individual Christmas trees will fit together to make a big Christmas tree. On that back whiteboard, you can see that the star's already there. Carol's got some magnetic strips that you can stick on the back, sort of like sticky tape. You'll be able to stick your Christmas tree up once you've coloured it and cut it. And I'm going to actually come back and ask if there's anyone who'd like to share the thing that they're thankful for. So that's what the kids are going to be working away at while they listen into the talk today. But coming back to this topic of faith, part of the reason that we need faith is because there will be things that stir in us fear. And you need faith to walk through fearful circumstance. At that lunch that I was at on Friday, the chair of the Mackay Churches Together, Amanda from New Life Church, she shared her perspective on fear, and she said what she's taught her children, and you kind of got to imagine the thick South African accent she has as she say this, but we don't fear anything, she said, but we have wisdom in everything. So we don't fear anything, but we have wisdom in everything. And I kind of like that. So we don't fear snakes, we don't fear spiders, but we have wisdom as we're around snakes and spiders. Or if you get into a circumstance where you're fearful, you still pray and you ask God for wisdom. How do I walk through this circumstance? Don't fear. We don't fear anything, but we have faith. We have wisdom in everything. And again, being freed from fear, it does assume this faith that we've got a God that we can call out to, that we trust in. We've got to believe that He is God and that He is for us. And so, again, this question asking, how do we strengthen our faith, and particularly how do we strengthen it in the face of fear? And another thing that I just want to touch on quickly before we get into the passage itself is that another thing that faith enables us to do is to walk in doing good. At this lunch on Friday, we had the mayor there, Mayor Greg, and he was sharing about how something that's really on his heart at the moment for our community is homelessness. There's kind of the normal homelessness, not that we would like it to be thought of as normal, we want to see it gone, but there's the normal homelessness of people who have fallen on certain times where they're kind of not even really looking for a house or don't even know where to start to find a house. But at the moment, our community is facing a time where there's people who are being called maybe the working homeless. So they have a job, they're working, but they can't actually find a house to live in. And so they're either bumping from motel room to motel room, or they're just camping, or even staying in their cars with children in our community. They're homeless, even though they have a job, because there is such a shortage of available housing for people in our community. And as you try and think through a situation like that, it takes faith to be willing to actually think into it and pray into it and act into that and try and do something to make a change. It's a lot easier to just look at the problems and kind of stir fear and just complain about the problems, but it takes faith to go, you know what, we're actually going to step into these problems in our community and see what God would have us to do. How do we find the faith to be a force for good as we head into 2023? I'm going to pray and then we'll open up the scriptures together. So please join me as we pray. Loving Father, Lord, we just come to you at the end of another year. It's been a big year. And so, Lord, we just place ourselves in your hands. And Father, we pray, Lord, that this morning you would speak to our hearts, Lord, that you would allow us to know you as our loving Heavenly Father, and that you would stir faith by your Holy Spirit in our hearts. And we just pray and ask that. We come desperate for you, Lord, and we pray that you would work in our hearts today. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, well, as we open up Isaiah and chapter 7, as I said, we're confronting this scene where Isaiah was speaking to one of the kings, a king named Ahaz. And so if you pick it up just in Isaiah chapter 7, verse 1, where Christy started reading from, Isaiah 7, verse 1 says, Ahaz, or when Ahaz, the son of Jotham, so see the diagram, the son of Jotham, the son of Uzziah, when he was king of Judah, well, King Rezin, the king of Aram, and Pekah, the son of Remaliah, king of Israel, marched up to fight against Jerusalem, but they could not overpower it. And the house of David was told, Aram has allied itself with Ephraim, and so the hearts of Ahaz and his people were shaken as the trees of the forest were shaken by the wind. And so you see the situation, two nations, Aram and Israel, they've come together against God's people, Judah, and we're told that the king and his whole household, they are shaken with fear. And so what happens in verse 3 is that Isaiah goes with his son, an interesting name, his son, Shear Jashub, but Isaiah goes to speak to the king, and what his son's name means, if you've got a Bible that has a little reference at the bottom of that name, it means a remnant remains. So just keep that in your mind, a remnant remains. It's important. Isaiah was told for a particular purpose to take his son. But really what he goes to tell Ahaz is that though you think Jerusalem is going to fall, it is not going to happen. You don't need to be afraid. But this really puts a challenge before Ahaz. Will he believe or will he continue in fear? You see at the end of verse 9 there, the last part of this word that Isaiah speaks, he says, if you stand firm in your faith, or if you do not stand firm in your faith, if you don't believe me, you will not stand at all. And so there's really a challenge that's put before Ahaz. Will he believe the word of the Lord as it comes to him, or will he shrink back in fear? Will he stand in faith, or will he shrink back in fear and so not stand at all? And really God is giving Ahaz this invitation, and we'll see that it's an invitation to believe God's word, also to believe this sign that God was willing to give Ahaz. And I'm going to put to us today that really there's an invitation being extended to us as well this morning. It's an invitation to relationship. It's an invitation to faith. Will we walk in faith, or will we shrink back in fear? So let's begin just thinking about this sign that the passage goes on to talk about. Of course, in the bigger sense, it's fulfilled, a sign fulfilled in Jesus. But you see this invitation as it goes on to King Ahaz. It's interesting here because Isaiah is speaking to him, but verse 10, we see this word that's very personal, and it's even written as if it comes directly from the Lord to Ahaz. Verse 10, it says, again, the Lord spoke to Ahaz and says, ask the Lord your God for a sign, whether in the deepest depths or in the highest heights. But Ahaz says in response, I will not ask. I will not put the Lord to the test. And it seems like a very kind of religious, very upright, very pious response here from King Ahaz. He says he doesn't want to put the Lord God to the test. And of course, he's quoting almost from scripture here, Deuteronomy 6:16, do not put the Lord your God to the test. And in fact, Jesus himself, when he is tempted by Satan, will use these very same words. He'll say, no, I don't want to put the Lord God to the test. But as you actually look into the context of the situation for Jesus versus the situation for Ahaz, you'll begin to notice that these are very different circumstances. For Jesus, he had Satan coming against him. And Satan said to him, look, why don't you go stand on the top of this high, I think it was on top of the temple, throw yourself down, and God's word says that he will lift you up. His angels will come and minister to you. Why don't you do that? And do you trust God enough to do that? Essentially, Satan is saying. But Jesus, in that circumstance, it's not actually God speaking to him, it's Satan. And Jesus recognizes that Satan is actually tempting Jesus not to have faith in God's word, but actually to shrink back and be a little bit afraid. Maybe God's word's not true. Maybe I need to test out God's word and see if I can actually jump off the top of this temple and see if God is good. But Jesus sees right through and he says, no, I'm not going to put God to the test. He doesn't listen to Satan. But of course, Ahaz, in Isaiah chapter 7, God is giving him a direct and personal word. In fact, God wants to stir Ahaz's faith. He's just said, you are not going to get wiped out by these nations coming against you. And he says, I want to build your faith, so ask me for a sign. Ask me for whatever you want, Ahaz. But Ahaz rejects the word of the Lord and says, no, I'm not going to ask that. And he even uses scripture to kind of justify his lack of faith and his action of fear. God is not impressed. Have a look at verse 13. That's where we get this language of the sign. Then Isaiah said, Isaiah 7:13, hear now, you house of David. Is it not enough to try the patience of humans? Will you try the patience of my God also? Therefore, the Lord himself will give you a sign. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and will call him Immanuel. And so Ahaz doesn't ask for a sign, but a sign is given nonetheless. There will be a virgin who will bear a child. So the virgin and her son, who will be called Immanuel, become this sign to the world that God's word is true. And of course, as we saw in that reading from Matthew chapter 1, this word is fulfilled. Mary is told that she has a child that has come by the Holy Spirit. She is found to be with child. And then Joseph is shown in a dream that this is in fact a child that has been conceived by the Holy Spirit, that God truly is going to come and be with his people. And that's where you get in Matthew chapter 1 verse 22 this confirmation that the sign has come. The word of Isaiah has been fulfilled. I'll just read that quickly. Matthew chapter 1 verse 22. This took place, this appearance of the angel to Joseph, it took place, Matthew 1 22, to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Immanuel, which means God with us. Really quite an amazing prophecy, and amazing to see how it was fulfilled. I can remember when I was first a Christian, and it just kind of blew me away looking at prophecies like this, where you had this prediction hundreds of years before Jesus came onto the earth, detailed predictions that, I mean, Jesus is a baby. He couldn't write the script or kind of try and make it fit his life. He's in the womb. And yet God gives this amazing prophecy before he steps foot on earth. Unbelievable. I mean, other prophets, I was looking into other religions at that time. Muhammad, there's no prophecy about Muhammad coming hundreds of years before he stepped foot on the earth. Buddha, he wasn't announced before he came onto the earth, details about how he would be born. But with Jesus, I mean, this prophecy is uttered by Isaiah over 700 years before this happened to Mary. Amazing. It's a sign for the whole world to see and marvel to this day. It stirs faith as we look at this sign in that general kind of big picture sense. But what about the more personal senses? What about the things that maybe are stirring fear in your heart at the moment? The things that you're a little bit afraid of as you look towards 2023. Well, it's worth noting in this passage that this word that came to Ahaz, it was for him a very personal word. Chapter 7 and verse 14, if you just pick up Isaiah 7:14 again, where he's given this sign, and we'll read the couple of verses afterwards so we can see how personal indeed it was to the circumstances that Ahaz was living through. 7:14, therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign, the virgin will conceive and give birth to a son and will call him Immanuel. He will be eating curds and honey when he knows enough to reject the wrong and choose the right. For before the boy knows enough to reject the wrong and choose the right, the land of the two kings that you dread will be laid waste. The Lord will bring on you and on your people and on the house of your father a time unlike any since Ephraim broke away from Judah. He will bring the king of Assyria. Do you notice some of the details that are given there and the way that it's explained? This child will be born, and in the early years of this child, while the child will eat curds and honey, very kind of specific details. And in the early years of this child, just as the child's starting to come to the ability to choose between right and wrong, these two kings that Ahaz is fearing, they'll be wiped out. And of course, verse 17 specifically, it tells us that the king of Assyria would come. If you've been with us this term, you might remember this diagram that talks about kind of where we're up to as we're thinking about Isaiah. The kingdom had divided in two. Isaiah was speaking to the southern kingdom, Judah. But of course, that northern kingdom, Israel, they were indeed wiped out by the Assyrians. They never became a nation again. What Isaiah prophesied did come true in Ahaz's day. And so it raises this question for us then, how can these verses be talking about Jesus as the child who would come to earth some 700 years later, when it seems from the context that it's a very personal, specific word to the circumstances when Ahaz was living? And I think we can rightly say that there is this greater and more ultimate fulfillment that comes in the future through Jesus. But there was an immediate fulfillment that is going on in the context in which Ahaz was living. And the context in Isaiah gives us these clues. I'll try and move through this quickly. It does get into a little bit more detail, but I think it's worth us thinking through these questions as we think about really the fact that even for us today, we join Jesus in becoming this sign. When it comes to this virgin bringing forth this child, actually in Isaiah, right early in the book, we have heard mention of a young lady. And that young lady in the context of Isaiah is actually Jerusalem. Isaiah chapter 1 verse 8. Daughter Zion, another name for Jerusalem, is left like a shelter in a vineyard, like a hut in a cucumber field, like a city under siege. Unless the Lord Almighty had left us some survivors, we would have become like Sodom and we would have become like Gomorrah. And so this kind of this picture that's built right from the beginning of Isaiah, that though he is prophesying this judgment to come, there is daughter Zion emerging who will give birth to those who will follow as those who are faithful to God. Chapter 1, verse 26 continues to speak about this. Speaking of Zion and Jerusalem, I will restore your leaders as in the days of old. Chapter 1, verse 26, your rulers as at the beginning. Afterward, you will be called the city of righteousness and the faithful city. Zion will be delivered with justice and her penitent ones with righteousness. There's this picture that there will be a remnant, though Judah and Jerusalem will be judged, there will be this remnant that comes forward. Jerusalem will remain and there will be children who come forward who are faithful and who are righteous. Chapter 5 verse 1, the Lord is singing over this young woman that he loves. And then in chapter 6 we see that Isaiah is commissioned really to bring in the first instance a word of judgment against God's people. And yet even in that context it is very clear that there will be this remnant that comes forward, chapter 6 and verse 13. Though a tenth remains in the land, it will be again laid waste, but as the terebinth and the oak leave stumps when they are cut down, so the holy seed, notice that language, seed means offspring, the holy seed will be the stump in the land. And so you're getting this building picture as you work through Isaiah that there will be this faithful remnant remaining, daughter Jerusalem, and then the holy ones who will come out from her. And it's interesting as you look later in chapter 7, because really this sign is unpacked and explained even to Ahaz. Chapter 7 verse 20. The people will be wiped out by the king of Assyria, and yet for the remnant who left behind in Jerusalem, they'll survive on curds and honey. They won't be able to plough their crops, but there will be a fruitfulness with their animals so the children can eat curds and honey. 7:22 talks about that. As you get across to chapter 8, we start hearing about children. Isaiah has another child. This time, in chapter 8, the child is called swift to plunder because Aram and Israel, they will be plundered. And it's interesting, in chapter 8, verse 8 and 8, verse 10, you get this language of Immanuel, God with us. What that means for those who fall back in fear, for Aram and for Israel, is that they will be destroyed. That's what it means to have God with you. And yet for the faithful, those who trust and continue to have faith, they will be left as this faithful remnant. They will be the sign as Jerusalem gives birth to this small remnant which will go on and carry faith forward. Have a look at chapter 8 of Isaiah and verse 16. I think this is the final passage I want to look at. Speaking about Isaiah, God speaks to him and says, "Bind up this testimony of warning and seal up God's instruction among my disciples." So notice here, Isaiah is faithful. There is this group of disciples gathering around Isaiah who are faithful. And here's Isaiah's testimony, verse 17. "I will wait for the Lord who is hiding his face from the descendants of Jacob. I will put my trust in him. There are some who remained," and that is the sign to Ahaz. And then Isaiah says in verse 18, "Here am I and the children that the Lord has given me. We are signs and symbols in Israel from the Lord Almighty who dwells on Mount Zion." Quite a powerful word as they continue in faith. Isaiah and his children and these disciples who have actually been willing to listen to the word that Isaiah brings, they become these signs and symbols, God with the people, because they have not shrunk back. They are signs and symbols to the world around. And you know, if we continue today in that same faith, if we continue to trust, well, we too are signs in this world, signs of Jesus, and signs that the presence of God is still here with those who have faith and trust in him. The children of God who trust in Christ, and of course the fact that Christ has taken this judgment that comes with God's presence, will they continue to bear his presence to a watching world around us? And I don't know how you feel as you look around Australia at the things that are going on in our society at the moment. I mean, if you listen to the media, there is so much that is against God's people and against God's ways and against God's words. There is laws that are passing through our parliament and have even passed through this year, both state-level laws, well, that's particularly what's on my mind, state-level laws that have been passed that are utterly against God's plans and purposes. The entertainment industry. You flick on Netflix and the kind of message that is coming across is not a message that is from the Lord. Our schools. There is so much that is against God and against his people. And yet, I'm not afraid. If you walk with him and do the things that he calls you to do, you can be more and more confident, and you will see it. God is at work in this world. He is genuinely with his people, even in the midst of this cultural moment that we're experiencing. I mean, God's people are doing wonderful things in this town right now. Amazing just to hear some of the conversations that went on with the mayor on that lunch on Friday. And people who have walked out of very difficult and messy situations and were sitting at the table having found hope and God's presence as they had trusted in Jesus. And we should expect that, right? Matthew 28, 18 and following, Jesus said, "I will be with you. My disciples, anyone who listens to my word, I will be with you till the very end of the age." That is his promise to us. There is nothing to be afraid of. How do we build faith that God truly is with us? How do we build faith in the faces of the things that we're tempted to fear? Well, I want to just go back and think about this invitation that Ahaz had. Because really, God doesn't expect us to have faith beyond the place where we're at. He gives us invitation after invitation to just step that little bit deeper into faith with him. It's a little bit like that song that we sang. We step out into the ocean and we find him there. There is an invitation to us. And of course, Ahaz, he doesn't take that invitation. God says, "Ask me for a sign, any sign." And he says, no, he gives a religious response and fobs God off. But not so when Jesus was born. You think about, for Mary and Joseph, this virgin Mary who is told that she will bear a child, and she receives God's word, though it would have been difficult for her. Joseph, the first thing that he thinks through is he wants to get out of there. He doesn't want any part of what God is doing as he is with us. But of course, God gives him an invitation. God comes and meets Joseph in a dream. Matthew chapter 1 and verse 20. After he, Joseph, had considered this, divorcing Mary, who he was pledged to marry, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins." And God here really breaks the normal of order of things, doesn't he? Normally, for a faithful couple listening to God's word, like this couple were, Mary and Joseph, they're like the faithful remnant. And the normal order of things is that they would get married and then they would conceive and have the child. But God turns things on their head. She is pregnant before they are married. And it's kind of a bit of a sidetrack, but I think it's worth mentioning. Do you know that this is actually a powerful picture for the church today? If you are someone who has trusted in Jesus Christ, you are part of the bride who has been pledged to Jesus, but we're not married yet. That doesn't happen until Jesus returns. And yet there is this expectation that for the followers of Jesus, those who have trusted in him and are part of this pledged bride, that they will be pregnant as they stand in faith and offer the words that they have believed in to those around them who will likewise trust and believe and go forth from them. There will be this multiplication of disciples. I've heard it talked about even as new churches are planted, that they're meant to be planted pregnant. They're meant to be planted and kind of this new thing that's been born, but ready to birth another church. That's how God's people are meant to operate in this world as they walk by faith in his word. Bit of a sidetrack. But the point here is that Joseph had this invitation from God as this angel appeared and he accepted the invitation. Matthew chapter 1 verse 24, when Joseph woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him and he took Mary home as his wife, but he did not consummate their marriage until she gave birth to a son and he gave him the name Jesus. Kind of awkward thing to obey, right? To go through with the marriage ceremony, knowing that your wife is pregnant. That in the years ahead, the people will be able to do the maths and realize, oh, that was actually before you were married that she was pregnant. And then when people ask you about it, to have to say, yeah, but the baby was from the Holy Spirit. An angel came and told me. Right, okay. Not the easiest word to believe and act on and walk in. But it was an invitation from the Lord nonetheless. Joseph took it. Will we take it? The last few months, I've been walking through. I've had this skin condition, kind of a rash. I've figured out finally what the technical name for it, but it's escaping me. Psoriasis, I think it is. But I've been walking through with this rash. And I mean, I believe that God is a God who heals. And yet it's been a month, maybe a couple of months, that I've had these sores all over my arms and all over my legs. And I've just had to walk with faith, kind of, God, what do you want me to do? And he's kind of prompted me to get a couple of people to pray for this skin condition that I've had. They've kind of shared things that have kind of taken me deeper in walking with God. It's like being this invitation to trust him. One of these times, I had a small group of people praying for me. And as they prayed, the word that came forward and they confirmed that there are a few of them that said, yeah, I got that word as well, was bitterness. There's bitterness you've got to work on, Jai. And that kind of sent me back to scriptures. You see Miriam in the Old Testament who was bitter against Moses and she ended up with leprosy on her skin. She was speaking against Moses. And so there's kind of this warning that's coming to me and really a call to repentance for speaking against God's people. You see that kind of idea come up again in Hebrews chapter 12. But you see, and praise God, I'm almost totally healed of it. But my point is that I accepted the invitation in that. Kind of awkward. It's like a judgment falling on you as you get kind of a disease thing that you're battling against. But I accepted the invitation. I prayed about it. I listened to what God had to say about it. And I want to ask you the question this morning, what's going on in your life at the moment? What are the challenges that you're facing? What are the things that are stirring fear in your heart? And more important than that is, what is the invitation that God is extending to you today? What is he saying to you right now as we head towards 2023? And maybe even more important again is, as you receive that invitation, are you taking hold of it? Are you accepting it? Are you willing to act on it, though it might mean disgrace and humiliation for you? He wants to build your faith. And for some of us, if we're honest, we treat Jesus just a little bit like he was a good man, a prophet maybe. We don't treat him like he was God and is God today. But you see, that was not what was prophesied. Isaiah said, God would be with us. And he was. Jesus came. And he came to take God's judgment. And he is now risen and reigning and Lord. And that means that if we come and follow Jesus, we can legitimately say that God is with us. I can say, God is with me. And that might sound a little bit arrogant to you for me to say that, but I mean, if God is not with us, what hope have we got in this world? But we have great hope because Jesus has poured out his presence by the Holy Spirit, and all who trust his word and walk according to it will be filled with ever-increasing measure of it. And so you might be wondering here this morning, what is God saying to me? As you think about the challenges, as you think about the things that are stirring fear in your heart, what is God saying to me in that? Well, I really feel led this morning to actually give us a moment to just sit and listen to God. I'm going to just give us a time, we'll shut our eyes, and I'm just going to lead us in a prayer and just invite God to come and speak to us and to give whatever invitation he wants to give. He might speak a phrase, there might be a thought that comes to your mind as you're thinking about the situations you're facing as we head to next year. It might be that he gives you a picture, he might give you a scripture to go and look up, or just a phrase that you think that's probably in the Bible and you might be able to go and find that. It might be that he gives you nothing now, but in the days or weeks ahead, he might bring you a dream, or someone might speak to you and you hear their words and you think, whoa, there is some weight and some gravity for me in that. But let's just spend some time, just a moment in prayer, if you'd be happy to close your eyes, and we just invite him in so that he might invite us in. Heavenly Father, Lord, we just thank you that you are a God who extends an invitation for a relationship to us. Thank you for Jesus. We lift up his name. He is risen. He is living. He is God with us. And he has sent down his spirit. And we thank you for that, Father. And Father, we just pray right now that you would send your spirit in our midst. Father, I pray that you would speak by your spirit to our hearts. Give us the invitation that we need in our circumstance to know what you are calling us and speaking to us to do, whether it's something to pray, something to respond to, something to reflect on. Father, we just give you this moment now and open our hearts to you. Thank you, Jesus. And so you might want to chat to someone after the service if God has given you something. What do I do? I think this is what I got. What do I do? Because we've got to act. We get a word. We've got to act. We've got to listen. We've got to obey. Friends, we started asking some of these questions. How do we strengthen faith? How do we strengthen it in the face of fear? How can we move into 2023 with this conviction to do good and to do it confidently because God has stirred faith in us? And we've seen that we have this wonderful sign. Jesus was God with us in this world. And in fact, that means that as we come to him and receive him as the one who has died in our place, we actually become his signs to the world. We are the disciples. We are the children who bear his presence to this world that so desperately needs him. And I just think, imagine 2023, that you decided, that's it, I'm not going to hold back anymore. I don't want fear, I want faith, I want confidence, I want to be able to walk in good and in love. And so whatever God speaks, I'm going to listen. No matter how hard it is or how difficult it is, 2023, this is the year. This is the year for me and God. If he gives me an invitation, I will take it and I will do it, whatever he says. Can you imagine what God might do through you if you were willing to walk in that? Can you imagine the freedom that might come in your life if you were just to listen to what he said and to do what he says? Can you imagine the good that would be worked, the joy, the thankfulness at the end of next year as you reflect back on what he has done through you. Well, I want to urge you and encourage you. Accept that invitation that has come to you today. Don't despise it like Ahaz did. Take it. Take it. Amen. Okay, well, I'm done, and I would love to hear from the kids. I don't know if any of the kids are happy to share with us something that they're thankful for. Turn around, adults, and have a look. They've got their Christmas tree set up on the board there. That's awesome. But I wonder if one of the kids is happy to put their hand up. It'd be great to hear from a couple of the kids about something that you're thankful for in 2023. Throw your hand up. Yeah, Ollie.
Family and friends.
Family and friends. Awesome. Yeah, Jet. Oh, who we got? Is that Micah?
Ninja.
Ninja. Enjoyed doing ninja. Wonderful.
Being alive.
I miss that.
I think it was being alive.
Being alive. That's a wonderful thing to be thankful for. Every
pretty
breath,
high bar every... in the Jenner household.
Yeah. Anyone else want to put their hand up and tell us something they're thankful for? We've got a Lily, Jenna.
My mum.
Ah, isn't that beautiful? Very good. Anyone else want to put your hand up? Something you... Rosa. Oh, get the microphone so we can hear you.
God.
For God. Ah, that is a wonderful one to end on. Okay, Phil, why don't you come up? Phil Hall, you're going to lead us in prayer. Thanks, brother.
Let's just take a few moments to pray. Lord, we thank you that we created in your image. You made us to be with you, to be like you. And Lord, you love us just the way you created us. And Lord, you want us to be back with you, and you sent your son Jesus so that we might come back to you. And Lord, because we know that with you, Immanuel, with you, we have safety, we have a second chance, we have peace, we have love, forgiveness and abundance. But in your presence, Lord, and we thank you, Lord, that you walked to the cross and you rose again and you sit and pray for us now to come back to you. And Lord, help our hearts to say we want to be with you, Jesus. This Christmas, Lord, may our prayer be that we want to be with you. We want to walk with you. We want to have fellowship with you, walk and talk and follow your in obedience. In obedience, we want to follow you. Lord, help us to do that. Show us signs. Lord, we thank you for this fellowship where we can meet and encourage one another. Lord, for all those that don't know you, who are out of fellowship with you, Lord, we ask that you bring them back to yourself. Use us, Lord, this Christmas to welcome people, to love people, so that they might be with you through us. And Lord, as we go into next year, Lord, we pray that you would continue to be with us and we would always choose to be with you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Righto, stand up if you would like. We'll sing a couple more songs.
How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that he would give his only son to make a wretch his treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, the Father turns his face away, as wounds which mar the chosen one bring many sons to glory. Behold the man upon the cross, my sin upon the cross. on his shoulders. Ashamed I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held him there until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me life. I know that it is finished. I will not boast in anything. No gifts, no power, no wisdom. But I will boast in Jesus Christ, his wrath and resurrection. Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer. But this I know with all my heart, his wounds have paid my ransom again. Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer. But this I know with all my heart, his wounds have paid my ransom.
We know this. Does anyone know this? Hands up if you know this. Oh man, we're in trouble. Jai, do you know it? Jai knows it. Me and Jai know it. You know it? Cade knows it. It was on the list, so if you don't know it, you're learning a new song right now.
Arise, my soul.
You do know it.
Sin, and he buried it. No longer I who live, but Jesus lives in me. For I was dead in sin, but I woke up to see the light. For your glory. Oh. us for your glory.
To the chorus again.
No longer I who lives, now Jesus lives in me. For I was dead in sin, but I woke up to see the light.
Grab a seat. Phil, do you mind just staying there? I reckon new song, we might just do it again at the end. It's a great song to finish on, if that's okay with you. Yeah. Just quickly before we do that, just a couple of notices. So if you are visiting with us new here at Make, we'd really love for you to get connected into our church family. We'd love to help you out any way we can. One way that you can help that connection is on the back desk. You might have signed your name on the welcome book as you came in. There's a checkbox there to receive our weekly emails and just really to give us permission to reach out to you and just make that connection. So I really encourage you to tick that if you're new with us here at Make. That'll be on the back desk just the next couple of weeks. So next Sunday, I'm actually away for the week. So Jonathan's going to be sharing a message from Romans chapter 12, I believe, next week. Yep. And so the kids will be in with us again. And then the week after that, I'll be back and we have our Christmas Day service, same time, 9:30 in the morning on Christmas Day. That's always a really joyful celebration to remember our Saviour, the God with us who came into this world on Christmas Day. And then the two Sundays after that, 1st and the 8th of January, is when we're having our break as a church. So if you come here, you'll be the only one here, or maybe one or two other people. So probably don't come here. Stay away for those weeks. And then the 15th of January, we'll be back like normal. We have a guest speaker on that Sunday because myself and Carol will be in Liberia for those first couple of Sundays that we start back. And so we've got a friend of Jonathan and mine from Brisbane named Dave Pitt. He'll be up, and then Phil Hall will be preaching the week after that in January. And then we're kicking off a new series. So that's Christmas service, new series. We're going to be thinking about the Gospel of Mark starting next year, the first term of next year. So clear thinking. You kind of have these moments in the Gospel of Mark where Jesus will say, wow, that thinking that you just expressed, that's revelation from the Father. Or other points where we'll say, wow, that thinking, that was from Satan, that wasn't actually from God at all. And so we want to have clear thinking about ourselves, about our world, about Jesus. And so I think that's going to be a really refreshing way to start 2023 for us. One last bit of news from me, and then Carol's going to come up and give an announcement. So just an update on our Make finances. We talked about that, I think, the start of last month, that we were in a pretty tricky situation as a church. Real turnaround in November, so praise God for the money that he's provided through November, and just encourage you to keep our church finances in your prayers, but really thankful that that just puts us in a better spot as we kick off 2023, seeking to continue to be a vibrant church, on fire for Jesus, growing in him, growing to know him better and seeing others growing and becoming part of our church family and continuing to be a Bible teaching church. We want to land ourselves on the scriptures. Jonathan's reminded me we don't have to pack up today, so don't just leave everything as it is. For the next few weeks we can just leave it, which is awesome. We get a bit of a break over the holidays of set up and pack up. Carol, do you want to come and talk?
Thank you. Morning, everyone. We're going to have a bit of a show and tell with Alf and Shirley, but whilst they're coming up here, one of the things I'm really thankful for is all the different ministries that happen at Make. And getting a bit of a behind-the-scenes sneak peek, it really is like a well-oiled machine that just as you walk through the door on a Sunday, you see everything that's already happened and been set up. But God has really gifted each one of us as the body of Christ with something that is unique just to us. And we need to bring that uniqueness to come and serve the Lord by serving the church. And so you might have guessed by now, I'm doing a bit of a call out at the end of the year as we're going to be doing rosters for the ministries for next year. We would love for a few of you, as you've recognized God saying to you, yeah, that's what I really want you to do at Make. We need someone to help set up. If you would speak to Johnny afterwards, Johnny's going to be a bit involved in some other things next year. So we would really love for one more person to come and say, hey, I would love to do that for you guys. We have a worship team up here most Sundays, and I don't know about you, but I just love coming to sing and praise God and worship in that way. And if you feel that God's calling you into that area of ministry, please speak to Bea afterwards and she will happily slot you in. And then finally, a morning tea call out, but I'm going to let Alf and Shirley do the show and tell. Thank you.
Good morning. This is actually blatant advertising. We are after more people for the morning tea team, so no excuses. But we're part of an amazing morning tea team, Shirley and I, and about five, six others, and we're really after some more people to help do that. We would like to get it so there's enough to have one person per 2 months. If that makes sense. Shirley will explain the detail of what we do with these boxes.
I will explain. This has all been streamlined for ease of use, actually, and with our team of people, that they have sort of condensed everything to actually only just two boxes. So as you can see, this is our snack box, which the kids love, of course, after the service to come over and grab. So this is one box, and this is the B box. So it's all been beautifully labelled. So we only need two boxes. So this is the snack box. And this one... this one is actually what we call the drinks box. This is box A. This is where your teas and coffees and cups and spoons are all in. So all you need, if you are willing to help us, we probably only need about two more people really, or two families on. Just pick up these two boxes. These will all be prepared for you. And that's all really what you need to take, apart from the milk and that, or whatever you want to bring yourself actually along. So you're most welcome to make something up yourself, or if you refuse not to, that's fine. There's plenty of food there anyway, with biscuits and stuff as well. So I think that's all I need, and we are quite happy serving on the coffee. It's quite easy. It's quite fun, but having spreading it out a bit more is actually quite a welcome thing to do. It's part of service, as you all know. We have so much service to do in a church community, and a lot of people are doing a great job, and we thank you for that as well.
Thank you. Thanks so much, guys. So chat to Carol, or you could chat to Alf and Shirley if you'd like to follow up and help out in 2023. Okay, kids, you've done it amazing. We got one more song in us? Yeah? We're okay. Okay, well, let's stand up. As we sing this song, I no longer live, Jesus lives in me. God is with us and he is living through us. Think on those things as we sing this song together, and then we're going for a coffee cart, morning tea. Enjoy hanging out together. Thanks, Phil.
Arise, my soul, remember this. He took my sin and he buried it. No longer I who live, but Jesus lives in me. For I was dead in sin, but I woke to see the light. No, I won't boast, but in the cross that saved my soul, or else is lost. The grip of fear has no hold on me. So I was dead in sin, but I woke up to see the light. All of this for your glory. Oh, all of this for your glory. see the light. Oh, all of this for your glory. Oh, all of this for your glory. For your glory, no longer I who lives, but Jesus lives in me. For I was dead in sin, but I woke up to see the light.
Amen.